station and/or senior center, and would they support the town to go back with a request to DCR for a land swap for cemetery site?
That did not involve the rail trail.
That's the best we could do?
That's all, that's all we came up with.
Did you think of anything?
I was the one who added the cemetery land swap fund.
That's actually a good question.
Yeah, yeah, we never asked for that.
I think I got 7 o'clock. Good evening, welcome to the Board of Selectmen Sewer Commission's September 21st meeting. All members are present with the exception of Siobhan Bonson. She's going to be a few minutes late, I believe. First item on the agenda is public comment. Mr. Sweetman?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Just identify yourself for people that...
My name is Dave Sweetman. I live at 23 Newton Street, and I am here to request that the board look into the possibility, or the feasibility rather, of having the library access moved from where it is, requiring library patrons to cross Newton Street to the library side of Newton Street. Of course, the primary interest is in pedestrian safety. As we know, Newton Street can be busy. As we know, oftentimes speed limits are honored in the breach. And as we know, in order to access the library from Newton Street, pedestrians, children, whomever must cross the street. There are a number of concerns around this concern for public safety. The library parking on Newton Street now is restricted by 7 driveways, 7 utility poles. Of course, there's the Odd Fellow driveway and the crosswalk. All of those, by my guess, assuming that a driveway is 10 feet wide, and we know that the clearance is 5 feet on either side, so we are obstructed or denied about, you could go anywhere from 180 to 200 feet of parking. The topography is such that at least partway up the street, the side of the driveway is very high above the street, so parking is on a slant. My observation, I didn't take any pictures. I figure in these concern times, people not want people taking pictures of their license plates, but it is not at all uncommon for the automobile to obstruct the right-of-way or the drive or the pedestrian way, or even both, the way they park. Of course, with the losses to driveways and the Odd Fellow and those, we're down. As I said, I think it could be as much as 200 feet of parking. But the other concern with the topography is that the terrain slopes downward from the front lawns of the houses on Newton Street, on where the parking is. Therefore, when there is snow, snow melt flows across the walkway into the street. Since it's a steady flow, whatever the temperature, treatment gets washed away. My own experience is that it's impossible to walk on the sidewalk during the winter in times of freezing, regardless of the terrain, which if you take a look at it, it looks like Belgium after World War I, but the machine that clears it cannot do an adequate job because of the way the walkway is. The second thing is that the freezing on the walkway, and then it flows down into the street. In my travel, since I live at 23 Newton, oftentimes you're forced to walk, if you're coming up from the library, facing traffic, you're 4, 5, 6 feet out into the travel lane because of the ice. So if a car is coming, you have to get off, step into the snow. So those are the principal objections that I would have. That now, as I said, you know, the speed can be a concern, particularly coming up from Central Street. People are oftentimes anxious to get around the corner and get and they really don't bother to slow down very much while they're at the library. There have been no accidents that we know of, at least in my memory, and I've lived there for 45 years. But if you think about the risk reward, the risk right now, we could say the likelihood of risk is very low. But the penalty for the risk can be infinite. If someone is killed, there is no mediation. The reward would now be for the town, if we do nothing, is we would save money. But I think that the risk far outweighs the reward. You might say, well, why now? After all these years, I've lived there for 45 years. What caused me to wake up? Well, there's an expression you get used to hanging, if you hang long enough, and that may be what we're looking at. By my visual inspection, it looks like property ends about on a parallel with the front of the library building, which would leave considerable room now for both, and I understand we would eventually have to have a walkway, for parallel parking and for a pedestrian way. I do not know what the terrain, what the layout is, so that would be one of the first things to inspect. It might even be, if it's feasible, that we could go forward without waiting for a full paving and a full whatever else is needed. We might be able to go forward and start parallel parking even with town services. As we have with the parking now, there's quite a bit of stone and some kind of a clay mix now to prevent subsidence, but the subsidence is continuing. So that's why I am here. I would request that you put this in your agenda, start evaluating the feasibility. If it's not feasible, it's not feasible because of the property lines. You will know what the footage is needed, I do not. But so that's my pitch. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. As I said, it's been there all along, and luckily we've lived with it. So, any questions?
I just have one. What exactly are you asking to be done? I missed that part.
I am asking that the parking be moved onto the side of the street with the library. The parking now is across the street from the library.
Okay.
And pedestrians have to cross the street. And
so it's very possible that they, under your, as you see, it'll be busy, that they might use both.
Well, it is busy in the mornings, it is busy at noon. We know that in another day or two or three, the clock will change, it will be dark in the evening. We do know that in the wintertime, cars are covered with salt, road is covered with salt, right. The sky in New England is gray. And so there is all of that. But mostly, it's the fact that we have people with children in strollers. My observation is they do not go to the crosswalk.
Right.
It's inconvenient. It's inconvenient. Yeah.
They park on both sides of the street now.
No. It's posted no parking on the library side of the street. See, I don't know if it's northeast, south, or west, so I say library side. Right.
Yeah.
It's kind of on the...
No, no, that's right.
Is it handicap parking?
Just two spots, yeah, there's two spots. And then a few at the...
Say again?
Yeah, there's just a few handicap spots, and I think at the beginning they might pack on that side of the street.
There is parking, yeah, they do have the 20-foot clearance from the intersection with the curb stop. But that's the other thing, from Church Street, on where it's parking now, it's substantially illegal to park all the way up past the, because of the 20-foot offset. And people are, I live there, people park within, well within the 5-foot clearance. Sometimes we have to thread the needle to get out or get in.
Is this something the board would be interested in looking into?
Sure.
So, yeah, I think it's a good idea if we can put that on a, well, maybe a future agenda, we can...
And I would urge, if you can move forward without a, you know, a perfect solution, that we do so. If we could use town facilities to clear them and put down something to prevent subsidence, I believe it's, particularly in the winter, the ice is really bad down there. Down 5-6 feet into the...
Good idea.
Into the, I guess, southbound lane. And they come off Newton Hill pretty fast.
Okay, thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time. I do like open mic.
Thank you, I'm glad you came. Any other public comments? Sir, you can step forward. Have a nice night, Mr. Sweetman. Identify yourself and your address.
First of all, good evening, board. Appreciate the time. For the record, my name is Craig Shibley. I live at 2 Lost Oak Road. We prepared a comment to follow up to our discussion. Take about 2 minutes to go through. That's all the time I'll need. On January 6th of this year, I came before you to address two separate concerns involving this community and its police department. One, the Central Mass Law Enforcement Council, otherwise known as CEMLEC, and two, certain fraternal organizations associated with the department. I was advised by this board that, quote, that if you have something you need to follow up with me with, you let me know. Well, that was 9 months ago, and 9 months have passed, and there's been no communication, at least that I'm aware of, to me. I can only then reasonably assume then that no further investigation took place, despite the fact it was suggested by Mr. Crowley at the time to have town council look into these matters. Consequently, I'm here tonight to provide this board with more facts to further validate my concerns and hopefully compel you to act as this community's legal governing body. According to board minutes from April of 2008, quote, whenever there's a change in the policy and procedures of the police department, information is forwarded to the Board of Selectmen for review. Presumably, such a review would have taken place in open session, whereupon public records would have memorialized West Boylston's decision to join CEMLEC in July of 2008, as in no doubt impacts both department policy and procedure specific to participation, call-out, and cost. However, a careful review of the 07 and 08 board minutes revealed no such discussion concerning the town's decision to join CEMLEC and authorizing the police chief and town administrator to sign off on. Furthermore, CEMLEC policy regarding admission specifically states how legal authorizing signatories are either one, a selectman, or a town manager, not a town administrator. And furthermore, that each town, quote, is duly authorized to execute this agreement before doing so. With no discussion on record and no formal authorizing vote, and former town administrator Leon Gaumont, if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, signature on file with CEMLEC, I ask rhetorically this poignant question: how then is the town's involvement legal? As for my concerns about CEMLEC specific to its evolving FEIN number and federal grant monies, public records from the IRS and this so-called nonprofit regional law enforcement entity reveal undeniable red flags that should and cannot be ignored any further by this board. Now turning to two known fraternal organizations associated with the police department, MassCop Local 172 and the West Boylston Police Benevolent Association Incorporated. According to 2009 financial records, the Benevolent Association accepted more than $10,000 from its unnamed, quote, predecessor organization by way of a transfer of funds. The 09 tax return also reveals how the organization asserts how, quote, the return constitutes an initial filing. Therefore, all activities included in this tax return have not previously been reported to the IRS. But according to the Secretary of State's office, the Benevolent Association was formed in 1974, dissolved a decade later for an unknown legal infraction, then revived in July of 2009. Here's where things get real murky, though, gentlemen. A 1998 annual report filed by the association shows its FEIN number as 04-2963849. That's troubling because, one, it shouldn't have been operating business since it was legally dissolved. And two, the IRS had already assigned this very FEIN to MassCop Local 172, the union's local nonprofit. I do believe also an officer then serving as the association's vice president remains on the force to this day. A 2007 IRS filing by MassCop Local 172 also shows it was doing business as, quote, the West Boylston Police Association. This is important because that's what was reflected in the organization's annual reports to the Commonwealth in both 2003 and in 2004. But once again, the Benevolent Association was acknowledged by the same officer as the West Boylston Police Benevolent Association with the FEIN 04-2963849. Once again, that's the FEIN associated with MassCop Local 172. So again, how could that legally be? Two nonprofits with the same FEIN, one of those entities supposedly also dissolved at the same time. Off the state's radar, of course, and off the IRS's radar. This FEIN conflict happened one last time, in 2009, ironically enough. The very year the Benevolent Association was, quote, revived and filed papers with the AG's office claiming its new FEIN as 27-2559301. It also submitted another annual report with the Secretary of State, though, claiming the FEIN was that of MassCop Local 172. Lastly, it should be noted on the record, this referenced officer, when submitting the necessary application for revival to the Secretary of State's office for the Benevolent Association, would again use MassCop Local 172's FEIN number 04-2963849, dated July 2009. The same time, the Benevolent Association was revived. The paper trail strongly suggests the police department was using one FEIN for two nonprofit entities that was suddenly and inexplicably cleaned up in 09 when a local tax accountant took over. Now, I'm not suggesting something illegal took place. Only an audit could determine that, and I'm not an auditor, as I've already stated on record to you. But do note a certain story in the news lately involving the Burlington Police Department, as well as an older story last year about a veteran Illinois cop who staged his own suicide in an attempt to cover up embezzling and laundering department funds. The once unimaginable, is now possible. Unfortunately, it's the world we all now live in. Again, there are undeniable red flags, and until disproved, should warrant the immediate attention of this very elected body. That being said, I do hope to hear from you soon this time to learn what, if any, action you intend on taking. Thank you.
Amen.
Yes.
I don't remember the details of when you came to us 9 months ago. I know I took very specific notes, and at the very next meeting, if you look at the, and I don't know if there's any new allegations in what you just said, this was a while ago, if you look at the minutes from the meeting after you came to us, I took notes on everything you said, and I investigated it, and I spoke with the accountant. I don't recall all of what I found, and the reason I don't recall it is I didn't find anything untoward that happened. And what I found, and the trail of the changes in the EIN and the state attorney general's numbers and all of those things, I put out at the very next public meeting, and it will be reflected in the minutes of that meeting. Now again, I don't recall what your litany of things that you had discussed 9 months ago. But I know all of the points that you had discussed with the EIN at the very next Selectmen's meeting were addressed. If that didn't make it to you, or if that wasn't satisfactory for you, it was not ignored. It was put out at a public meeting. And again, from my recollection, I don't remember exactly what happened, which I know that means when I looked at it, I was satisfied that the reasons for the EIN changes was acceptable. So everybody that's watching knows I'm an accountant. I do this for a living. So if you would consult the minutes from the meeting, the very next meeting from the last one you came, I think you'll find a lot of the answers that you're looking for.
Mr. Crowley, I respectfully and vehemently disagree with you. The onus, arguably you could say, is on me to follow up. I brought this before you, so if you followed up, I think a courtesy on behalf of a resident of this town would have been in order. So whatever you may have said or may have documented, that's on the record, and at my time and my leisure, I'll look at it. But right now, if you're satisfied with a nonprofit operating under two FEINs, hey, maybe it's a funky accounting thing that, you know, people I talk to, well, I'm just saying. Okay, all right, but right now, it's my understanding this is just a public comment. It's not a time for interaction. I appreciate Mr. Crowley's time, but I think what I've laid out here is quite clear, that there are two FEINs with two nonprofits, one operating, and it's suspect. It's at the very least, Mr. Crowley, if you can't come to the at least the presence and the position that it's questionable and suspect, then you and I just aren't going to see eye to eye in this. And I've consulted with some higher up people who are very well versed in accounting. And furthermore, the Semlec thing, there's no record, sir. I've looked at that too. So now it's your turn then to check the minutes, because there is one person on this board who was there in 2008, and there should have been records of it. That's all I'll say at this time.
Okay, sir, one second before you go. I would ask the town administrator if I believe we were supposed to follow up. I thought you might have met with the chief after our meeting. Is that true? I recall that.
That was my understanding also.
Yeah.
I did meet with the chief.
Okay, that's fine. No, I'm just checking if that happened.
He did have.
If there is any information from town council that can be shared with him, can we get it to him? I don't think we told him that we would do that. And then possibly those minutes for him if we can't find them online, if they're not online. What was the date?
I went to the clerk's office. There was
I would have them, but what was the date you were here?
The date I was here?
Yeah, the last time you were here.
January. It was okay. January 6th.
Of 2000? 16. So maybe the next meeting might be some information. And then we'll, I'm sorry, go ahead.
If I can interrupt, just for the record, I mean, I spent an inordinate amount of time going through the Board of Selectmen minutes in that time period. And the document that was, there were no minutes memorializing it. No vote could be found in those minutes. So if these minutes somehow now appear, then I'd be very curious to see those minutes.
In regards to what?
The Board of Selectmen authorizing the Chief of Police and the town administrator at the time to then sign off on the town's involvement with Semlec.
Right.
If something is there, I'd be very curious to know that suddenly it appears, because I spent too much of my time, a couple hours of my life, I'd like to have back.
I appreciate that.
I'm pretty good at
seeing that. Let the town administrator speak, and then we'll move on.
Through the chair. Craig, you have a lot of detailed information there, and Nancy and I were writing furiously during it. Is it possible? Could I?
This is yours.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate that.
Okay.
Thank you.
We will follow up with the information if something comes up. Thank you. Okay, next item on the agenda is September 7th, meeting minutes, approval of meeting minutes, September 7th, regular session.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And September 7th, 2016, executive session.
So moved.
Okay. I have a motion and second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Next item, a few minutes late. Senator Chandler, Representative O'Day.
Somehow can exist, even though I have in my file that it's swelled, I can't find it.
Okay. If I have questions about this, can I email you?
It's all right.
This is developing a new problem.
Good evening.
Hello. Do you guys have anything you want to start with? I know we had some questions for you, but if you want to...
I should ask a question, your questions, if you don't mind.
Okay.
I'm happy to be here, that's all.
Yeah, we're both happy.
Happy.
It's good to be here.
I wish if you could just...
I just met your new administrator.
There you go.
And we're delighted to meet her.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So you'd like to hear the questions that we had? What was the, can you just...
Our first question was, could you give us an update as to the status of the $5 million that had been earmarked for the Goodale Park improvements?
Well, you've gotten the money that was earmarked last year at the same time, actually, for the library. Mm-hmm. That's already given. The $5 million seems to have attracted a lot of attention. And it, frankly, I'm worried about it. The governor doesn't seem to be in a mood to allocate that money and release it. We are on a regular basis now running to the governor's office, and we're both doing this, and saying, please release the money. They've been waiting for it now for over a year, and please release it. I want to release it before the governor has the opportunity to do NIAC cuts, which we feel is coming in the very near future, and we'll worry about that. I don't think it will be cut there because it's a bond.
It's a bond, right.
It won't be cut there, but the mood is not one of expansion. The mood is one of, we're worried about our finances, and $5 million would be a lot of money for him to release, to be honest with you.
I mean, I think I tend to agree with the senator's take on this. You know, I thought that we were very fortunate to be successful in getting you know, this particular project in the bond bill, because as you know, there's many, many projects from communities around the Commonwealth that we compete with. So, you know, I think we were successful in our efforts in doing that. But once that happens, and I certainly want to commend everybody on the board and others here in town who have taken to the letter writing campaign to continue to try to keep this on the front burner. I don't think we should stop with that by any means. I think we need to continue to do that. But the fact is, there's one person that can release those funds, and that's Governor Baker and his administration. So it's our job to continue to let him know that it's there, that our town would be extremely thankful, right, and grateful for us to have that opportunity. But the bottom line is, that's really who releases the funds.
And just to clarify, we had the library, we had some money for Worcester Street, and we had this.
Right.
The library was what, like 40,000?
40.
40.
And I think Worcester Street might have been 2-something.
250, I think. Yeah.
Okay. I know we got the library money.
Right.
And what, since you're talking about money that we have asked for, we earmarked here, I should tell you that efforts are starting to begin to develop the governor's budget. That's House 1 in the first year of the biennial. And I would suggest that if you have any pressing needs, I'm going to say it to you up front, please let both of us know. First, he's the most important person because he's got to get it in the House budget. But I would have to get it in the Senate budget. And we would like to have it in advance so that we can make the case for it, either in the budget or if the appropriate bond bill comes up. Bonding is different than a budget. A budget has to come out. Bonding doesn't have to come out. And it can build, and that's what has happened here. It's building. It's like a Christmas tree in many ways. I think sometimes we look at it that way because it sounds very good initially that you've gotten this money. But unless the governor releases the money, you've accomplished very little. I mean, it sounds good and it can be released, but when times are difficult, as they are right now, there's less chance of us releasing the money.
Any questions in regards to this issue?
Nope.
What was the next?
Well, the next, unfortunately, flows in the same vein, and I think we know the answer to it, but As you know, we have the police station project that we're still working on. We will be going back to the town meeting on October 17th, requesting some additional funds to fund what we now know is a higher construction, well, total project cost than originally had been. We're looking now at $5 million. We'll know firm numbers on that once the bids come in on October 5th. So we will have very firm numbers to present to town meeting on the 17th. But as you can imagine, you know, some people are quite concerned about the additional cost for the police station. And we also have still the strong need for the senior center. So it sounds as though it's not likely that there would be any pocket of funds that we could ask for either project. Instead, do you know of any grant programs that might be available that could at least provide some assistance for either project?
Go ahead.
Well, I would say to that, I certainly have reached out to public safety with regards specifically to the public safety building. There are some grants available for, non-capital expenses, so operation stuff, right? There are some of those, but that's not what we're looking for at this point in time. We're looking for large sums of money to be able to actually build a public safety building. Beyond having reached out to Secretary of Public Safety, I've also made some inquiries of Congressman McGovern and his office. And regrettably, the response from the federal government isn't vastly different than the response from the Commonwealth's government, that there may be certain pockets of monies, but again, it's for equipment, it's for vests, it's for vehicles, those kinds of needs, not the type of capital expenditures that we're needing here. In addition to that, I did file legislation last term, which did not go terribly far, with regards to trying to determine a methodology of, like they do with the school system, right, with the school building authority. So you find a specific sort of revenue resource that you can take a percentage of. And I think, frankly, that's probably a route that we might be able to make some headway on, because we're not alone in this issue, right? There are lots of communities like ours who need a new fire department, or a new fire building, or a new public safety building, or a new senior center. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's not under public safety, but it's the same type of mechanism that we have to have a broader sort of, that would be more fulfilling to a variety of communities, and that's just the community of West Boylston.
I would suggest to you that it is almost time for a public safety bond bill. I know we don't want to talk about bond bills again.
You have such good luck.
But we've had such good luck in the past. But we haven't had a public safety bond bill in a long time. And I would think that our chair in the Senate and Harold Naughton, who is the chair in the House and comes from Clinton, next door to you, are very sensitive to this issue. And I would hope that perhaps maybe a letter from you saying how much you need it, and how I'm sure there are other communities that are in the same situation that you are, that this would be an appropriate time. Public safety is on everybody's mind at this point. And I would push that. I mean, I really think we should do the same thing. So I'm hoping that that we can get this happening. This our public safety chair is a fellow named Jim Timmelty, and Harold Naughton, who is, now I don't know whether these two people will have it in the next term, but they might well. But I would get the letter to them now and get them start thinking about what your needs are as a community. You're not alone. Now, as far as the senior center, we differ on this. I don't believe that the state has ever funded a senior center, to my knowledge. They've funded it once, and it was a going away gift to Senator Brewer two years ago.
And I'm not even sure what town it was of his. He has 30 towns. But he did get money for a senior center. That's the only town that has ever gotten a senior center. You know that from your own experience.
It's actually the town of Hubbardston, which I just came from.
Okay, but it was a gift to Senator Brewer. So I think we have a real hard time here. I would suggest that you start thinking about how Clinton do it. I represent Clinton, and they worked hard to get that senior center. And God knows, you need a senior center. The facilities that you're currently using is, I'm not going to say less than ideal. I would say they're really, they're sub-marginal, I think, for people. You want people to feel comfortable and very much at home, and you want to encourage them to come. So I would hope that you would look at a town like Clinton. How did they do it? Holden has done it. Holden has a magnificent senior center, but that was paid for by the town of Holden. I think you will find almost every senior center, with the exception of Hubbardston, has been paid for by town and private funding. I think of all the things that you're talking about, I think we would have the hardest time getting the senior center. I think in comparison to the public safety office that you're talking about, I think there's a chance of that. I think there really is a chance. But I think you have to start pushing it. And if you know of any other towns that are in the same situation, encourage them to join you. We listen to numbers.
Anybody have any questions in regards to this issue?
With regards to a public safety building, we're in the process now of designing it. If we got a bond bill, miraculously there was one next year, is that something that we could do it as a reimbursement if we've already expended the funds, or is that?
The problem with the bond bill, you've just seen the problem with the bond bill. That money has to be allocated.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's no guarantee, right?
Have you ever seen where, you know, the project's half done and, hey, money became available, here's the rest of their money type thing happened before, or is that pie in the sky at this point?
I think, I don't know of any.
I'm not familiar with that, no.
Actually, Worcester developed a fire station without, and that was right after the big fire in 2001. And I believe that they started building it without the money from the state. And there's a lot of nagging, a lot of work on it. I can tell you all about it. I would suggest you also talk to Holden about building a public safety facility, because they built a new police station a few years ago. And I would talk to them about how they did it. You know, we all learn from each other. There's nothing new under the sun here. How did they do it? How did they get, maybe you can get some private funds for it. Maybe you can work something in relationship to, you're housing a public safety facility, a big one, and you're getting not a dime. I'm sure I don't have to remind you of that, but you're not getting any money for it. You're not getting any assistance. And I think when you write about your need for a public safety facility, you should also say that you are housing a facility here already that you have the full responsibility for. And it does take, it eats up some of your services, certainly your public safety services. You can tell them how many times your firefighters are called over there. It's not once or twice. Put it all in. You have nothing to lose.
Right, but as Mr. Crawley said, the items that you brought up are good ideas, but they're the long term.
Well, yeah,
if we don't have the funding for the future,
it's nothing.
But if you two both retire, will they give us things?
More so probably for the senator than me. Because
I mean, it seemed like it works somewhere else. If both of you go, will we get more? We'll move on to the next question.
Yeah, that's...
I can't wait to hear it.
You're asking for them at the same time. That's the unfortunate problem. You're asking for public safety and... You're talking about police rather than fire, I take it?
Police.
And you're asking for a very much needed senior services. I mean, you really do need this. Is there any building in town that could be renovated?
No.
No? Nothing?
We've already gone down that road.
We're moving forward.
Yeah, we're...
Moving forward.
We have a portion of the money, and now we're going to town meeting for the difference.
Are you asking, so you're going to town meeting?
We already went, yep.
For the police station?
For the police station.
Police station, okay. And where would that be?
On Route 12.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
On the other side of the inside of the reservoir. It's already, yeah, we own the land, we're just getting prices. I mean, we have prices, we're going to have firm prices in about a week.
Okay.
And we'll go to town meeting.
Okay.
In the senior center, we're going out to conceptual plans. We are working forward with that also.
You know, obviously, as the senator said, we are moving towards a budget period, right? There's nothing preventing us from telling the administration that we have X amount of dollars, we have the beginnings of what we need for a police station. You know, can we get additional dollars, whatever that might be? Obviously, it sounds to me would be in the millions, but, you know, whether it's in his budget, or the House's budget, or the Senate's budget, we could at least make a request, you know, and given the hardships that I think that we have with our public safety building, who knows? I mean, I think that we're working there with some really, skittish conditions.
Yep.
Right? They're working under very, very difficult conditions at the police station.
And list them all.
Yeah, and we make that part of our argument for, listen, the town's already come up with X amount, maybe we, through town meeting, we're able to raise it a little bit, but where we have some of our own skin in the game, I think that could make a difference as we go forward. Again, no guarantees, obviously, but there is that window for us to make an effort at that, right?
You might also want to check to see if there are any foundations that are interested in dealing with bricks and mortar for public safety. You know, public safety's kind of got a lot of pressure on them at this point in time. And I think I would make a point of saying that you're concerned about it. You've already raised some of the money yourself. And are there any foundation? You know, there's a foundation book in the Worcester Public Library. It tells you every foundation and what they do. You don't have a foundation person to do that, so I guess I'm looking at you and saying, I assume it'll be your job. But it's worth your while to just check it out. There's some foundations that just build brick and mortar for healthcare facilities. And maybe there's something also for senior centers.
Yeah, maybe we can look on our side if you
we'll
folks can maybe.
We'll look on our side,
yeah.
Too. How's that?
Good question. I mean, we've been looking.
I know you have.
But yeah, we'll continue to do that.
Okay. And final question was in regards to land swap. We've never talked about this
although
before.
Although I understand you met earlier with the members of the Cemetery Commission, but one of the concerns that we did have are that we are running out of land for our cemetery. We do need expansion space. The town had previously had discussions with DCR about the potential of a land swap, which has not had a positive reaction. I'll be working with the cemetery commissioners this fall to put out a request for proposals for landowners to submit proposals to the town for, you know, the town purchasing their land for the cemetery expansion. We're hoping we get some viable proposals, but if we don't, then it seems like it would be time to try to go back to DCR and say, we've exhausted all of our other opportunities. Please work with us now. Would you be willing at that point to help us give that very strong message to DCR?
Absolutely, and that message has been given. I can certainly speak for myself and I believe for the senator. That message has been given. We did have a discussion earlier this evening, and I think very shortly, we should convene a meeting again with the DCR. And they are aware of two or three or four parcels of land at the cemetery commission, and I have had discussions around. They're aware of those. It is a process, right? I'm sure that you're aware of that. Certainly, there has to be the transfer of the land, Article
'97.
'97, thank you. And then there is, you know, there would be some cost involved in it, depending upon, you know, what the actual value of the land is assessed at, and do we have a piece that we can swap with them? So there's a number of different variables that we can work with, but I think we have to all come to the table. And hopefully, I would say within the next couple of months, I will put together a meeting where, whether it's someone from, you know, your office, or the Board of Selectmen, or the Cemetery Commission, or all of us.
All of them.
And including the Senator, we need to have that conversation and you know, get to the bottom of it. We have to have a fix for the problem.
But it sounds to me, first of all, DCR owns so much of this community to begin with. That's always been a problem. So you don't have a whole lot of land in which a trade is almost inconceivable to me, to be honest with you. And I speak very frankly about these things. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it. But I think that that's a real problem. You don't have much to trade. So that possibly, good evening.
I apologize.
Possibly a straight out sale might be the best way with competitive prices. And it would be easier for the representative to arrange this after you have gone out and tried to get the request for proposals.
Right.
Because they could say, well, you haven't,
exactly.
You haven't checked it out yet.
Exactly.
And you probably might find something right here under your nose. It's easier to deal with DCR when you have all the facts on the table.
Right.
And they realize you're hard pressed. And bury your loved ones in this community, as in any community, is one of the requirements of the community itself. And you can't do that if you have 513, is that the right figure? 513 spaces left?
Yes, 513.
That's not a lot. We don't see a wholesale death going on here, but you know, that isn't too much in the future.
Exactly.
So you need another facility here.
Okay. So we'll be in touch as soon as we have completed that RFP process. It would be nice if we found a viable proposal that would resolve the situation.
Yeah.
But if not, then we will definitely be in touch with both of you and let you know that we're ready to have your help to get that meeting scheduled.
I've got to ask you a question. You say a viable proposal. How are you going to, in some way, contain the cost of that viable proposal? I mean, the town must know that you don't have too many choices here. How would you deal with that?
That's a very good question. I mean, using the RFP process, we have the ability to establish evaluation criteria, which the cemetery commissioners will be helping me to put together so that we can be sure that that we have a clear parameters in terms of the type of land we're looking for. But then in terms of establishing the value, it would have to be something that, you know, the appraisals would have to determine what the fair market value of that property would be. And somehow we'll have to put language in that RFP document to let the potential proposers know that that's the process that we'd be using, establishing by which
fair
to determine
value.
The value.
I think you have to do that. Otherwise, you're going to be held up.
Exactly.
To whatever somebody wants to charge you for that, and you can't deal with that.
Yeah.
So I would put that in very, very clearly that it is the fair market value that you will accept.
Does the board have any questions in regards to this issue?
No.
Does anybody have any other questions for the Senator and the Representative? Okay. I know we've had positive with the Mass Highway. We just did a sidewalk project that they worked with us. We have the work being done at the reservoir.
Good.
that we're having, I believe, some luck with them helping us out and working together.
Wasn't that done in the budget? The earlier
well,
budget?
Well, the sidewalks.
Yeah.
Yeah, sidewalks.
Not the work at the reservoir.
We've dealt with the gentleman from Mass Highway that in regards to a few projects that we've gone to some meetings on.
I mean, right now, obviously, that road is a little tough for folks that are traveling back and forth over it. I did have an opportunity to speak with the District 3 director a couple of weeks ago, and he was going to send some folks out to kind of take a look at it to see if there was any way of making it a little less ruddy, right? I mean, I obviously go that way every day, and I mean, the police are doing a great job with the traffic, no question about that, but the road itself is kind of tough. I know it's in the process of being worked on, but it's still a little tough.
In regards to the other project, we've talked to them about that, and we've got a lot of good answers on that, so there's some positive there. Any other questions?
Can I suggest something? We just met this evening with your municipal light company representatives. We're very impressed by some of the fairly advanced things they're doing as a municipal light company, and you should really be very proud of it. You're ahead of the curve, and you're way ahead of the curve, and what they're doing in terms of the landfill is quite wonderful.
Yeah, they do a great job, yeah. And does anybody else have any?
I do have one. Way back, this is regarding 40B. Way back in 2007, you have mentioned, you know, reducing the 10% to 5%. Is there any update?
Say that again.
40B, 10% to 5%.
40B, 10% to 5%.
Is there any update?
Oh, boy.
I've
been involved in housing, as you know, for a long time, and 40B is an issue. I thought you were there. I thought you were at the 10%, aren't you? No? Even with that project you put up? You put up a couple of projects that I thought, no?
I believe we're in the 7% range, if I recall. Yeah.
You're close.
You got close.
You're really close.
That 3% would mean a lot of houses.
I mean, yeah. Yeah. Just that.
When we go to Worcester, they're complaining that some of your people are coming to Worcester and using their services. So, you know, we can't seem to get away from it. I don't see any, I mean, there are people in the legislature who would love to deal with this 40B and get rid of it once and for all. But, you know, 40B is the only way that we have had a sizable number of housing units built for people who otherwise could not afford them. And we're talking not necessarily, you know, when I say people who not necessarily can afford them, I'm talking about people who work. I'm talking about people who have jobs. But I'm saying also that some of these people, and West Boylston does not fit into this category, but people who live in communities or work in communities for which there is a, maybe you have it, a 3-acre limit on the housing, and it makes it very difficult to have sufficient housing for the people who work in your own community. I don't think that's the case with West Boylston. You're also, one of your problems, and maybe this is a point that should have been made long ago, is that you've got your conservation, your DCU, owning half the town. You don't have a lot of land to build on. So maybe 7% is all that you can really adequately handle. I don't know whether you have any thoughts on this. Would you like to see it go to 7%? I guess you would.
Of course, if we're at 7%, we'd love it.
5%, you'd probably like it.
No, 7% is better. Anything is better.
I don't see.
Yeah. Lower than 10% is.
I don't see it happening. I mean, we've got a lot of other problems to deal with in this coming biannual session, and one of them is you haven't yet had the problems of citing not-for-profits. That's an issue that's going around, citing not-for-profits, and they're cropping up because of the Dover Amendment all over the place, and people are very concerned about that. We're concerned about making sure that there's enough housing. I don't know whether you're seeing people standing on your streets holding signs about really begging and having no place to live. Some of them don't want any place to live. I mean, some of them prefer to live on the streets, but for other people, there's the real question of how can they afford? And we're so much cheaper in central Massachusetts than they are in eastern Massachusetts. I mean, I think we're one of the great bargains of the state. Of course, western Massachusetts is even cheaper.
Right.
But you can't get into Boston and work. You can get into Boston from here and work. I don't see it happening. It's a terribly inflammatory subject in the legislature. The Senate goes crazy over it. The House goes crazy over it. So, you know, I hope we can get through this without dealing with it in this session, but never say never. Might happen.
Okay. There's no other. Yeah, I think if there's nothing else you folks need to add, I think you've already talked about the budget and things like that. Anita, you have anything else?
We would just like to know in advance, as far in advance as possible, any legislation that you would like to see in this session so that we can bring it early. Mm-hmm. As you know, if we file legislation in January, early January, we're able to move it more quickly. If you have any legislation, the budget requests, the earlier you can give it to us. Any sensitive needs that you have, if there's going to be a bond bill, let us know in advance, you know, so that we can know that, you know, West Boylston has a need here. Let's make sure we put it in. Otherwise, we're calling you at the last moment. We're asking for what you have. You don't have it priced yet because you're not that far along. So give us a little advance notice if you can. And know that we want to help in any way that we possibly can.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Appreciate it.
Coming over
tonight.
Have a
good day.
Good to see you. We'll see you soon.
Have a good night. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is payroll warrants. Accept, report, and vote to approve.
The next two items, Mr. Chairman, are related to one another. This is going to be a moving forward, something we're going to have every meeting. In front of you, there are five payroll warrants that have been signed off on. We need to just take a vote to approve those, and then. The next item under the agenda after that, there are school invoice warrants, sewer warrants, and then general town warrants that go from the 1st of July through September 19th of 2016 that we've all signed off on. We just need to take a vote to retroactively approve these. So I would make a motion.
So wait, the first one is, do we have to do the current one? It says to accept and vote. On the first one, and then it says retroactively vote.
You can roll them all together
okay.
If you'd like to in one motion.
So if everybody has a list in front of them, I'd like to make a motion to approve all of the warrants on this the list titled Town of West Boylston FY 17 warrants 7/1/16 through 9/19/16.
A second.
We have a motion and a second. Do I have any discussion on that? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, and then October 17th, semi-annual meeting warrant review.
All right. Each of you should have in front of you an updated version of the warrant article list and of the draft warrant itself. We have 20 articles currently. I'd like to just quickly review these with you and determine if you'd like to do a combination of the different articles. The first article is for a basic committee report. I'm not sure who we might be expecting to have report out at the special town meeting, but once we get the list of committees that would like to provide report updates, I'll get that to you. The police station, the additional borrowing authority, as we had briefly discussed with our senator and representative, that would be the second article. And that obviously is also tied to the ballot question with the special election being scheduled for the very next day, October 18th. We have Article 3 would be for some CPC allocations for looking for fencing for Goodale Park, additional funds for affordable housing, consulting services, and also to fund an open space purchase of land, approximately 12.5 acres of land. We then have a article for additional FY17 capital improvements. This specifically is dealing with the DPW's request for funds for a new loader. The Capital Improvement Board had decided to wait until the new DPW director was on board before determining what to move ahead for DPW requests. Our new director, Butch Jackson, has had the opportunity to review the equipment, and he feels very strongly that we should move ahead with the purchase of the new loader this year. So that is the one item that the Capital Improvement Board slash Finance Committee will be reviewing and bringing a proposal, hopefully bringing a proposal forward to town meeting. The fire department has put in three small requests, $11,000 for hose and storage racks, $8,000 for turnout gear, and then $6,000 for a new IV pump. We could leave these as separate articles, or we could combine them into one article, and that was part of what I was looking for some feedback from the board tonight.
Yeah, I think it makes sense to put them all as one article.
I don't see why not, right? Yeah.
There's okay. Consensus there to combine them together?
So 5, 6, and 7?
Yep. Yeah. Okay. That's what I will do. I'll rework that. We have an article for some additional funding for the fire chief's salary to meet our obligations under his new contract. We have expenses associated with the change to the Holden Regional Dispatch. The police officers and firefighters need to be trained on the new software system that Holden Regional Dispatch will be using. It's been different from what we have. So that would require that all of our public safety people get trained. It's an expensive proposition, unfortunately. The chief has said that he feels the maximum amount that would be needed would be $72,000. He's hoping to reduce that by quite a bit by doing some creative scheduling of the different officers or firefighters, so they can take the training when it doesn't involve overtime expenses. At this point, I'm putting in as a placeholder a not to exceed $72,000. By town meeting itself, we'll have a much firmer handle on what that might be. We know we have various FY17 budget fixes. As you are aware, the town clerk has additional expenses this year that we hadn't anticipated in association with the presidential elections, but also with the special election that we'll be having on October 18th. She's in the process of working with the other town departments and offices to see what else might be necessary under those budget fixes. We are keeping at this point a placeholder for prior year's bills, authorization of payment. We don't know of any yet, but if it appears that there are no prior year's bills that need authorization for payment, we'll just pass over that at the time of town meeting. The town accountant has also asked for, the cemetery commission has asked for an article for some transfer of funds, $18,000, from the sale of lots account for the purpose of purchasing a new mower. The accountant has asked for articles to be in the warrant for potential transfer of funds to both the stabilization and to the capital funds, if we're able to identify funds that would be freed up and transferred in. Then we have some non-financial articles. We have been looking at the West Boylston Public Access TV department, and we have some what we call contractors right now working for us, our access coordinator and production assistant. And we're questioning whether they should technically be considered consultants and be paid as a 1099, or if they should more appropriately be actual town employees. And at this point, based on evaluation of the criteria established by the federal government, it appears they really should be town employees. So I am working with the personnel board to have them establish these as positions and to grade those positions, but it would require, under our current personnel policy system, it would require a vote of town meeting to establish that. So that's what that article is about. We also have some corrections to the FY17 grade schedule that need to be done. There were some positions that were listed under the grade schedule at the time of the Springtown meeting incorrectly. The change of hours that have taken place in those positions The total number for their, annual total for their salary was not properly listed in the wage schedule, so we need to make those corrections. We have some home rule petitions. The first one is to bring back the question for changing the town clerk position currently elected to an appointed town clerk. And the others are associated with the DPW position, also had been previously discussed at town meeting under a citizen's petition. This concept of changing both the special act and our bylaws, our local bylaws, to remove the mandatory requirement that the DPW director have a bachelor's degree in civil engineering or related field, and make it a preferred qualification rather than a mandatory qualification. And that's basically it for the article list. In meeting with the town accountant today, we do have available tax levy capacity so that we could do the raise and appropriations necessary to fund those money articles at this point, including the highest amount for that public safety training. We're looking at $104,000, and we have plenty of additional tax levy capacity that we can use to appropriate the money needed for those different items. And that's it for review, unless you have specific questions about the language of the articles themselves.
Does anybody have any questions?
I think you skipped over 18, unless I just, on the alternate to the FinCom, I did.
Oh, I did. Thank you for catching that. As we had previously discussed, we had several individuals who were very interested in being appointed to the Finance Committee earlier this year, and at the time that appointment was made, it was discussed whether we could potentially add the position of alternate to Finance Committee so that we would have backup, so to speak, and provide opportunities for someone who's interested in being a permanent member of the board, be there in a learning capacity, and could step in as needed to deal with Finance Committee matters during the year. In checking with Town Council, that would require that we request a special act of the legislature to allow us to establish those positions. So that's what Article 18 is for.
Thank you.
Any other questions in regards to the articles?
One question. It's actually for the Capital Investment Board. Has the Capital Investment Board looked at the loader yet, or is that still pending?
And then if I could just ask, in regards to Article 17, is the town clerk going to speak on that at this meeting, or has she been asked to give input?
She has been asked, and I believe no final decision has been made, but she did seem to indicate that she would be willing to put forward her written recommendations and her thoughts on that. Had been in support of that change before, but that information hadn't been shared with the voters prior to town meeting or at town meeting. Right. The point here was that people might wonder why we're bringing it back up for reconsideration, and it is because she still is in support of having it be changed from an elected town clerk position to an appointed town clerk position. So in some way, shape, or form, we will help her get that information out to the voters.
Okay, even if it's a letter, that'll be that'll be good. Okay, any other questions in regards to the warrant? Okay, next item is the PACS Commission versus PACS Facility Committee change, possible modifications.
All right. Many of you were at a meeting that I had moderated earlier this year in the summer between the Parks Commission and the Parks Facilities Committee regarding the master plan for Goodell Park. And in the course of that discussion, there had been concerns about conflict between the role of the Parks Commission and the Parks Facility Committee in the charge that was established for each of those committees. The charge was originally established by the Board of Selectmen. In reading the charge of each, they do appear to both be tasked with this concept of developing and implementing capital improvements to park facilities. So over the past few months, I've been speaking to members of the Parks Commission to determine how strongly do they feel about this need to make a change. And I have feedback back from them. There is no clear consensus from the Parks Commission members about specific change that they might want to see be made in their charge or perhaps to be considered for the Parks Facility charge. I think at this point we can probably sit back and leave it as is based on the feedback that I've received from the Parks Commission. But I do think that it's something that we might want to be mindful of as we move ahead, hopefully, with a Goodell Park improvement plan. Because when we start to become very active in terms of going out to bid, developing, you know, specific designs, we need to be very careful in terms of having very frequent and high-quality communication between those two commissions, so that this concept of having conflict or lack of communication doesn't happen again.
Two things. There are two members of the Parks Commission on the Parks Facilities Committee, so if there's any lack of communication, it's due to the two members on the Parks Commission not reporting back to the Parks that are on the Parks Facilities Committee, not reporting back to the Parks Commission. But my question is actually a very specific one. Do you know, to deconflict this, did the Parks Commission ever take a vote one way or the other?
They did. They did. It was a majority vote to approve version C of the Goodale Park Master Plan.
Thank you.
And additionally, Jim Padone, who's chair of the Parks Commission, asked the school committee also to review the plan and see if they would vote in support of it, which they did. So both the Parks Commission and the school committee have voted in support of the proposed plan.
Excellent. Thank you.
Any other questions in regards to this? No, in regards to the Parks Commission versus Parks Facility, if you feel that should be brought back to us, you know, we can talk about it. If the boards feel that they would want it back to us, I would just ask that they vote. That's not one member says, I'd like to talk about this or two. I don't know how it worked now, but I would ask in the future that maybe the board votes at one of their meetings that we need to look at this, you know, in case. I don't know how it got here this time, but yeah. I know you spoke to him.
Right, there was no vote. I know Chris,
yep,
you were at that
yep.
meeting. And, you know, there did seem to be concern expressed by some members of the Parks Commission about this. But in meeting with them after that joint meeting and in getting actual written feedback from them, there's no clear consensus from the Parks Commission that a change needs to be made at this
right.
time. So that's why I'm proposing that we take no action.
Yeah, just so they understand that just like us, you know, we have votes of the committees to, you know, to bring things forward. So that's...
No, I think that they do have some legitimate concerns that the Parks Commission has to be in agreement in terms of the parks improvements that are being planned. And there does have to be, you know, close collaboration with them. You know, so I because there are appointments made under my watch,
yep.
I see that
you
as being my
right.
role that I have to kind of oversee that to make sure that that's happening.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Welcome.
The next item is Holy Cross Community Partnership Requests. We have three here. Library Sunday Hours, Annual Emergency Response Fund Contribution, and Unpaid Internship Program.
Right.
Anything you want to add to those?
You had tasked me with reaching out to the different departments and town offices and committees and asking what they might like to see us request of Holy Cross as part of this community collaboration, which would be suggested as being some annual funding that they would provide to the town in lieu of taxes for the new facility, the new retreat facility that's been built in town. And so I did, and these are the only suggestions that we've received from the different departments, offices, or committees. So the library was suggesting, and they actually had early conversations with Jamie Hogue of Holy Cross. They're looking to try to get a funding arrangement from Holy Cross in the amount of $60,000 over a course of 5 years, meaning $12,000 per year, specifically to fund some desired weekend hours that they feel are outside of the reach of what the town's budget can currently afford. The fire chief was looking for some funds that could be provided annually to be put toward the regular expense that we have of replacing the ambulance, where, as you know, there's been some concern about the ambulance revenues providing enough income to fund that purchase that needs to be made every 8 years or so, and that this might be something that Holy Cross might agree to, knowing that, you know, ambulance services are something that we would be providing to them during their retreats, and that this might be considered a priority item that they might give consideration to. And then in speaking to Jamie Hogue from Holy Cross, you know, he had offered himself that we could, you know, establish these other types of relationships with Holy Cross in terms of they're providing assistance to the town and, you know, using their students who are, you know, becoming skilled in certain areas we could take advantage of their labor, their time, their knowledge, and use them as unpaid interns to help, you know, different departments and dealing with different problems or projects that might be coming up throughout the years. So these are the three items. It's up to the Board of Selectmen to make a decision about what you would like to have is actually formally put forward as a request to Holy Cross. We are meeting with Holy Cross for that dinner next week, I believe it is, next Thursday, a week from tomorrow. So it'd be nice.
October 20th.
Oh, thank you. Excuse me, October. So, you know, that would be the appropriate time to try to put together a formal request. So we, you know, should give some discussion to this, if not tonight, at our next meeting. To decide, you know, which of these items, or perhaps all three, do you want to prioritize these items so that if Holy Cross says we can do one but not all, you know, that's a decision for the board to make.
I would, go ahead, you.
I question the one on the interns only because I know some people that use interns from Holy Cross and it's not paid for. So that's not, doesn't seem like that's anything out of the norm, that that is already an ongoing project that they have. Not that we couldn't right. take advantage of it, but I don't see, I mean, I do see that we could benefit from it, but if we're looking at dollars, from my understanding, from what I've heard and seen about the program, that's not going to benefit us on the dollar side. So I just wanted to share that.
Correct. I mean, it's very common for area colleges right. to, you know, provide unpaid internships for the students. So, you know, we're looking, you know, if it's something within the civil engineering program, accounting, you know, whatever, right. it's quite common for communities to collaborate with those institutions that are in their area. I think, though, that from the conversation that I've had with Jamie Hogue, you know, they truly want this to be a development of a really good relationship between the college and the town. So, you know, this would be, this internship would be a natural, and I think it could grow from there. And I think that if we had this arrangement with them, we might have a higher priority in terms of students being assigned to us versus other area communities.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're calling these community partnership requests. Is that, and I know we had discussions about they didn't want to do a straight up pilot. Is this the, in lieu of a pilot, this is the community partnership? Is this yes. kind of, this is our pilot ask
yes.
without calling it a pilot?
Yes.
Has the subject of a dollar threshold been discussed yet with them? Or are we, what stage are we at with?
It has not. The one thing that they have been fairly straight up on is that they are not willing to just hand us a blank check to be used however we feel to augment our operating budget. They want to know what they would assist us in funding. They want to know that what we're requesting is something that meets in with their criteria, their you know, their goals as an entity, as a nonprofit entity. So you know, I think that's why they had, you know, looked at this concept of the providing additional hours for the library as being a very positive thing that they could buy into because it meets their goal for education. One would hope that they'd also equally understand that this funding for ambulances or public safety equipment or vehicles would also be something that meets their goals, providing public safety to their institution, you know, to the people who use their retreat. And it's interesting that we didn't receive any other requests from the parks.
No, I don't find it interesting. I find it amazing.
Me too.
That all of our departments are in need of nothing.
They might have felt a little intimidated by the concept that Holy Cross would be trying to weigh it against what their value system is as an institution versus what the town needs.
That's not up to us to decide that. Let's
it's
take
up to them.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, let's ask them to help with the police department. Let's ask them to help with the senior center. Let's ask them to help with the development of Goodale Park. They're an education, you know, institute of higher learning. All three of those would fit in with their mission and their big dollar ask. This is a $20 million facility. They were paying taxes on it. It would be, you know, millions of dollars. So why are we asking them for $60,000 and
over 5 years?
Over 5 years. And let's ask. Let's ask for work.
This would be an ongoing, the library's proposal was specifically for 5 years.
Right.
The other items would be...
I would ask that we ask the department heads again to look at this question. Don't be afraid that we might not pick something that they're interested in. Let them tell us that. And then I would add to the list that use of the building for our needs, for whatever. We you know, if that's going to be possible.
It would be possible. Jamie has already offered that.
Okay, so if we can put that as one of the items, you know, for community events, for other maybe meetings that people want to use it for. I don't know the answer, but I agree with Pat. I mean, we need to put everything on the list and let them decide yes or no.
Summer programs.
Yep.
Using the facility for the summer
programs. Possibly for, yeah.
Meetings.
So, I mean, I think maybe if we can go out again and then maybe on the 6th of October, we bring this back up with, and then we can, if we're going to meet with them the 20th, are we going to talk? Is this one of the things we're going to talk about?
I think it'd be the appropriate time to bring it up. Yeah.
Is there any need at the school?
No, that would be at the facility, correct?
I thought it was at the facility.
Are you talking about the 20th?
No. I'm talking about Holy Cross. Will they support the schools as well?
Any needs for the schools?
Yeah,
that's an educational institution. So.
The school had nothing either?
Didn't receive
nothing.
Anything.
I thought there was something about scholarships way back.
We did talk about that.
There's nothing? They didn't ask for any scholarships or anything?
No, I think, I personally talked about the scholarships to give one kid a scholarship. How does that help the town? It helps one resident of the town of West Boylston. Out of all the kids that go to school here in other towns, I mean, if there's something across the board, they give, you know, 10 scholarships, not full scholarships, but they give scholarship money every year from Holy Cross that kids can apply for. That would be something nice, I think. But to give one student a chance to go to Holy Cross free, I personally don't see how that...
Rather, you know, they could support some other programs at the school.
Yeah, I think, I can't believe the school. I mean, I can't imagine Holy Cross would say no to different school. I mean, the librarian there, you know, things like that, funding work at the library and things like that. But if we can... Yeah, go ahead.
Like I said, I think Pat, you know, hit on the head with the police station, the fire station. How can they not ask for anything? It doesn't make any sense.
Well, the fire chief did.
Pay for an ambulance. I'm talking pay for a new fire station. Pay for millions of dollars worth of stuff. If we ask, the worst they can do is say, no, that's not what we had in mind. We had the $60,000 request in mind. Okay, that's great. All they can do is say no.
I think we need to go out to the department heads again, and then the 6th we can relook
we'll
at this.
Bring that back.
Just one other question, Mr. Chairman. Yeah. Is this something that would be every year would come up, or once we set this priority? Because I'm wondering if it's going to be reviewed every year, and we would change it as our needs go. So that would probably go into the dollar amount that Mr.
I did have that conversation with Jamie. You know, asking, is this something that you'd only agree to one thing that would just be done annually, or would it be something that we could, you know, change with each year, or the request would differ? And he said he would be up, you know, to having it be either way. You know, he could see that there might make sense to not having a commitment continually to the libraries, you know, for example, but provide some funding for the library for 1 year or 2 years, and then have the commitment be to something else that they provide for the town.
As a follow-up, I think we should invite him to one of these meetings. It seems like we have some general questions, and we might get a better idea before we put forward this. I don't know what everyone else feels like.
We're going to have a meeting with them.
We're going to meet with
the
public.
Right, we're going to have a public. The 20th.
So not till the 20th. I'm saying before the 20th.
It would only be, yeah. I'd like to confirm the list. I'd like to put the list together before we even sit.
Before we meet.
Yeah, personally, but that's...
Right, but I'd like to get an idea of where they're coming from versus, like, not putting you in the middle, but before the 20th, if we have this list to them, but then also get to meet them so we have an idea before we walk into the 20th meeting of, are we even close, or what direction are they coming from, and are we on the same playing field?
But rather than have that take place at a selectman's meeting, would it make sense perhaps to have a subgroup of you work with me and have that discussion with Jamie and whoever else he feels be appropriate from Holy Cross as representative, so that we would get that information faster?
Yeah, I think, well, first of all, before the 20th, we only have one meeting, and we don't even have a list together. We have maybe two, the 19th, but I think after we meet the 20th, I think in an ongoing, we should invite them to our meetings, you know, after we meet and discuss. But we have to look at where the town of West Boylston, we have one building in the town. The city of Worcester's been trying to get money from them for, and they have a whole neighborhood. So, I mean, I think we have to put a decent list together. I think the library's a great thing. I can't believe the school can't have something that could be funded that the college would love to do, I think. But that my thought would be, let's meet the 20th. We're going to have a meeting there anyway. And then on an ongoing yearly thing, or even after the 20th, we invite them to a meeting so the residents can know. But, I mean, I have no problem meeting in advance. But, I mean, the 20th, we can meet as a group. And then possibly after that.
Mr. Chair, if I may, are you in a position where you could pick up the phone and say, hey, we had a discussion. What order of magnitude of request are you looking, you know, can we bring to you? If he's thinking $60,000 over 5 years, perfect, and we come back with, we'd like you to pay for half a police station, he's going to say, what are you people out of your mind? So if we could just
what I was trying to get to.
Yeah, I'd be more than happy to have that conversation with him. I think I was hoping that we would have a better sense of some of the realistic department needs before that, so we'd know that. But, you know, I can say, based on the discussion of the Selectmen last night, you know, we're looking at items that are this big, and we're looking at items that are this big, and we need a better sense from Holy Cross, what parameters are you willing to have us work with you in? So I can absolutely have that phone conversation.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea, but I think we should do what you said first. Put the list. I mean, put the list together, because I don't think they're going to put a dollar amount. They're not going to put a dollar amount. They're not going to say, I don't think they're going to say, we're only going to give you a couple thousand a year. I think they asked from the beginning, they said, we'll gladly help out with different things in town, like the library, like the fire department.
All they can do is say no.
Right. So, I mean, let's ask.
I'll see what I can get out of them.
Yeah, I think we already have. Yeah, I think they said that they wouldn't.
Actually, now that Chris mentions that, they haven't thought about it, and they just said, it could be one of those things where we bring this to them and they say, okay, we have a committee, let's vet it. Whereas if we ask beforehand, and you know, they may come in with, oh, well, we discussed in this committee, we came up with this number, we may have lost an opportunity.
Yeah, I think so. But I'd like to just, like I say, add some of the things we spoke about, and scholarship for kids, you know, a fund that's put aside every year that kids can apply for. Not for the school, just for $500, $1,000, you know, whatever the case may be.
Okay.
And then we'll talk about it again on the 6th.
Okay.
The next item is sewer mandatory hookup status.
Right.
What do we got?
I think we're going to ask you to pass over this for tonight.
Okay.
In trying to do more research about this to give you information that you could discuss this evening, Nancy and I found ourselves finding more questions than answers. So I think we need a little bit more time to figure this out before we bring it back.
Put it on for a future meeting.
I think what I need to do is meet with the Board of Health before we bring it to you and get a few more answers, get some issues clarified.
That's
so
fine.
We'll bring this back to you.
Pass over that. Recognize the acceptance of $125.63 in free will donations from September 4th concert for the Bandstand Committee, and to approve expenditures of these funds for general purposes.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Town Administrator.
Okay. Some of these items on my report we've already talked about briefly. The first one being this issue of the public access TV employees versus our 1099 contractor technicians. So, I will be meeting with the Personnel Board on September 26th on this issue. As you saw, I have it as a warrant article for the October 17th town meeting. The fire station, as you know, did receive funding for replacement of the overhead doors, and they went through a full procurement process. So we do have a contract now with Rainier Overhead Door of Worcester, Mass. For the replacement of those three front overhead doors for the fire department, for the price of $16,706. So that work is going to start in September and should be done well before the end of the year. And that was a really good price. I commend our fire chief for working to really get that price down as much as he was able to. The other item is that I did meet recently with CMRPC, who is our regional planning agency, and it was interesting. They're really trying to expand the level of services that they provide to the member communities. One of the ways that they're doing this, they're taking on additional staffing, but the other thing is that they're starting to partner with other agencies in the area, other regional planning agencies, so that if one RPA has a level of expertise within their staff that one might not, they will work together to fill those needs for their member communities. And so in the packet, you should have their updated services guide. So I'm going to be starting to share this with all the different departments and committees, because I think that, you know, there are some things that we could be taking better advantage of. We need to discuss, though, what our areas of need are, and then look to see if we can build in funding for those, the purchase of that service each year. One of the thoughts I had on that so far was that the Zoning Board of Appeals has been dealing with a lot of issues with one of their 40B applicants, and you know, we have been going to Copeland and Page for legal assistance on that. But if we could find you know, qualified, experienced consultants within CMRPC who could be providing some of those answers to ZBA at a lower cost, it'd be much better to go to CMRPC to get some of those answers rather than go to Copeland and Page, who are charging us a higher rate of pay. So that's the type of thing I'd like to start looking at with the different boards and committees and departments. And then, you know, we may be coming back to you, coming back to Finance Committee to say, could we perhaps add additional funding in these areas so that we can take advantage of these services that CMRPC can be providing to us. And then just wanted to let you know that under the health insurance, we do have a wellness program offering for town employees, and I wanted to commend the Insurance Advisory Committee because they're working with Harvard Pilgrim, who's our major health insurance provider, to establish a wellness program. And we have some good ideas that are out there that the employees seem to be getting some excitement around. We have up to $3,500 to spend on this, and it could include anything such as walking programs, weight management programs, stress management programs. So, you know, it's something that the town has not done in a while, so it's really good that our Insurance Advisory Committee is actively working to get that type of benefit for our employees. And that's it for my report.
Okay, I will list the informational sessions we're going to have for the town meeting and the police station. On October 4th, we'll be at the Senior Center at 3 o'clock. On October 6th, we'll be at Hillside Village at 2 o'clock. On October 8th, we'll be at Christ Lutheran Church at 10 a.m. I believe that's a Saturday. October 11th will be at the Beeman Library at 6:30. That will not only be the police station article, that will be all articles on the warrant that night. And we will also present the police station information. October 13th, Angel Brook Village at 2 p.m. And October 15th, the town hall at 10 a.m. I believe that's a Saturday also.
Saturday.
Yeah, and then the town meeting, we've talked about it a lot. Town meeting is October 17th at 7 o'clock at the high school, middle school. And the ballot question will be go to vote on October 18th from noon to 8, I believe.
Right. And just one correction, the October 6th event at Hillside is 2:30 p.m.
It did say, I knew there was one change, I thought it was made. So that's 2:30. Okay, and that was, and then regards to FISC miscellaneous updates, are there, I don't think there's any other, nothing else.
Obviously all the meetings are open to the public, so we'd love to have any public come and attend, because, you know, there's a lot of discussion going on all the time, so we'd love to have, if they can come to it, it's wide open to the public.
And our next meeting is next Thursday, correct?
Next Thursday.
At 7 o'clock, which is... The 27th?
Wednesday the 28th, I believe it is.
Isn't that the one we moved to Thursday?
We just moved to Thursday.
We're still having the Wednesday meeting.
So wait,
to clarify for myself, I thought we did move it from the 26th to the 22nd, 27th. That's not the case?
So it's, the next meeting is next Wednesday, which is the 28th. That's the regular FISC meeting.
Okay, yep, 28th, yeah.
And then the very next day, there will be another brief FISP meeting solely for the purpose...
But it was moved, I did think.
Right, solely for the purpose of reviewing the sub-filed bid results that we get in. That's for, filed sub-bids are like plumbing, heating, painting, things like that.
I just recall, the project manager, the email he sent out said that we have the possibility of moving the meeting to the next night, so that's not what we're doing.
That's not what has been discussed.
We have both meetings, because, he's opening the bids at Thursday, isn't it? Thursday, at 2:00 or something.
So we're gonna have both, okay.
That's at 7:00 on the 28th, on the 29th as well?
Yes, 7:00 for both nights.
So, there you go, we have a meeting, so we all know now, the next building meeting is, the next FISB meeting is the 28th, and we'll have a brief meeting on the 29th. The next item is invoices, Reinhardt Associates, number four, for $1,320.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and second, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed? Next item is Cardinal, number five, invoice, for $5,850.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and second, any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed? Okay, and then under old business, we have report on September 21st vote of EACC on Curtis TIF.
Yeah, this morning in Worcester, the Economic Assistance Council met, and they did unanimously approve the Curtis Industries TIF.
Great.
That's great.
So, yeah, it was really good. It was a very interesting process. There were a number of projects from across the state that were being discussed today. But, you know, we did hear from Peter Milano at the event that, you know, they were very pleased with the very strong level of support that West Boylston showed this TIF application and how quickly it went through the process. So they were very pleased for that.
I'm sure they're happy.
They are very happy.
Yeah.
So what's the next step for them is?
So they, DNS Realty is in the process of trying to line up some engineers to come in and do some soil borings and some other surveying type work that needs to be done so that they can start to put together the plan for drainage, et cetera, on the property. They want to try to maximize the buffer on the back of the property as much as possible so that those residents from Angel Brook who had some concerns about the proximity, you know, that those concerns can be addressed to the best degree possible. So they're going to be working on that. They sounded as though they would be very interested in having one of those pre-meetings where they meet with each of our permitting boards and committees prior to formal filing. So Steve McGradigian said that he would reach out to us as soon as he felt they were ready for that, and we'll try to pull together one of those multi-board meetings to talk about all the ramifications of the permitting process.
The round table that we're talking about.
Round table, correct, yeah.
And then residents will have opportunity to go to planning board meetings. They'll have hearings. They'll be butters will be notified,
yes,
but anybody's, you know, can go
absolutely
for input.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions on that? Nope. Meetings and invitations. The B Memorial Public Library will be closed the last 2 weeks of October for carpet replacement. Go to their website for more details. And then also, we have been awarded a recycling dividends program grant in the amount of $5,150.
Thank you, Miss.
You missed?
Miss one item.
Oh, shoot, I missed that one. Sorry. Under old business is DPW assistance to Cemetery Commission. So, is that just for us to discuss here? Or do you have an update on that?
Well, you had asked Butch Jackson to try to put together some more information about what it would cost to have DPW do the work of digging the graves annually versus the cost of what Cemetery Commission is already paying. And in your packet, you'll see his response is that if you take all-in pricing, which would include the hourly cost of the DPW equipment to provide that service, that basically the costs are almost identical to what the Cemetery Commission is currently spending annually. So it would appear at this point that there would be no savings achieved if DPW were to take that process over versus the current outsourced contractor.
Okay.
Yeah, they went up from 6,500 to 9,700, his estimate.
Yeah, he, there were some, you know, we put him on the spot a little bit that night. And, you know, he was trying, you know, to provide some numbers to us that night. But when he went back and actually looked at everything, and we did ask him to provide a comprehensive look at it, to put in all-in costs, so we could have a true comparison, apples to apples.
Yeah, and both together, it's 15,000.
Oh, that was it. Oh, I thought he went from, he went, yeah.
He said if you add both numbers together, it's just over $15,000.
Correct.
But that's, they're charging that truck like it's a private company.
So it's industry standard that when you're right. trying to determine what the cost of providing a service is, you usually look toward the book rates that are established for the type of equipment. So in this case, it would be backhoe.
Correct.
You know, or there might be a dump truck involved as well. So he went and looked at the state's listed rates and applied those rates to the estimated number of hours for providing the task to assist the cemetery commission in digging the graves. And when looking at it that way, trying to provide a true all-in cost for giving that service, it ends up being almost equal to what the cemetery commission is being charged.
But I would think if we took that same scenario for everything else we do in town, we would be hiring companies to do everything, maybe. So, I mean,
You'll see in his email that he said you could potentially back out that hourly cost during the work week for the equipment, because if it's not being used for cemetery work, it's likely going to be used for something else. So if you back that out, I believe he said that there would be approximately a $12,000 annual cost.
Right, because every year we talk about street sweeping. If we took, to see if it's cheaper to go out, if we took our truck and said, we always say, well, we have the truck anyway, but if we use the hourly pay of that truck, then I would think nothing would be.
But it is a legitimate process to try to include
I don't
the cost
disagree,
of use
but,
the equipment.
Right.
It's
go ahead.
It sounds like the way he did it is more apples to apples
yes.
to compare.
Yes.
Because if we're going out to pay for it, we would be paying at that rate that he used. Am I correct?
Similar rate. You know, the contractor might charge a slightly different rate based on what they use
yeah.
for their, you know, okay. Rather than using a book rate as Butch did, you know, that contractor that we might turn to would probably have a different rate that he would apply to his equipment.
Okay. All right, thank you.
My only question, looking at his calculations, and if you can't answer this, I understand he puts this together. If, when calculating the labor costs, he's got two men at 8 hours a day. So why does he have 16 man hours per funeral?
That was based on conversation with the cemetery superintendent in terms of what they saw, or actually the number of hours that were involved in a burial. You know, there could be opportunities for the hours being less, where they could leave the site of the cemetery briefly and go do other tasks, so that not all 8 hours would be committed to that actual burial. But they were trying to provide a full all-in price.
So, just so I want to make sure I'm understanding the same. Bob and Joe go down, dig the hole. Mm-hmm. Butch may have them go do some other task for 4 hours. Then they'll come back and fill the hole, and they've worked an eight-hour day. And this appears like, we're not taking into account overtime, but just conceptually. And I understand that's what it's going to cost. They may not be dedicated fully to doing that. Just like the guy who's digging the hole now is not sitting there for 4 hours. He's going and doing something else and making money elsewhere too. But in this analysis,
that's the maximum. Yeah, he's using worst case scenario.
That's
the way to describe it.
That's what it would cost the town. Mm-hmm. We would be getting enhanced service. And in my mind, okay, so we're going to get enhanced services for the extra hours we're paying during the weekend, which essentially would make up for the lost hours that we would have for the same two guys digging the holes during the weekday. So just wrapping my mind around it conceptually, we're not filling any labor costs at all during the week. There are labor costs. There's no dollar cost for this labor cost. So this is an accurate representation of the costs and an argument we made to keep in or keep out the equipment, but I did ask Butch to put it in, so okay.
No, I think it is an accurate cost, but if we did that same scenario for everything in town, we might find that it's cheaper to do everything, that the, you know, but we own the truck, it's here, you know, we're not renting it out to them. This is a town, this is just part of the town. This is like, I think, the bigger picture of all of the maintenance that's done at the cemetery, if that could be taken over by the DPW. We can't, if we tried to price that out, we can't say, well, the lawnmower costs so much an hour, we're gonna bring a guy. No, they're just gonna mow that like they would mow everything else, so. I don't know where we go from here with that, but now we have the information. Does anybody have any thoughts on what we want to do with this information?
I think we need to look at the big picture, not just this one item.
I
looked at this one item, but yeah, I think we need to do a total analysis of, all right, here's how the DPW operates, here's how the cemetery operates, do we have duplication of efforts, and do we have the ability to potentially save the town money or enhance town services, one or the other, by looking at the way we take care of cemeteries.
I agree.
And I think we need to give Bush some time to do that. I mean, he's been on it 3 months, so I mean, it's gonna be a little bit of a process for him to analyze everything.
Yeah, tomorrow, can you have that for us?
And just so you know, the Cemetery Commission is meeting with the Personnel Board on the 26th, same night that I'll be meeting with them on the other item. They're looking to see whether or not there can be reconsideration of the wages for the cemetery superintendent. And also they had brought up to the Personnel Board's attention this concept of, you know, that the Selectmen had put as a goal investigating the feasibility of the cemetery department being brought into the DPW. So Personnel Board will be talking about that on the 26th, and I'll report back.
I know we're saying Butch is just here, and I totally agree that, you know, this can wait, but I would also want him to reach out to the cemetery commissioners so it's not just him working from his perspective, because I think if we're going to do a full range comparison, we need both sides to come to the table and work on this as a team.
I agree.
Right, I mean, I think it's cemetery needs, I mean, if we can save money, I think that's what we can do, a better service, or have our guys do the work. I just think it's something we need to look at, so I guess put it on his radar, and then we can talk about it at a future meeting. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I read the meetings. Future agenda items, our selectmen's reports. Anybody have anything? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to go into executive session.
I move to enter into executive session under the provisions of Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A, Part 3, to discuss strategy with respect to the collective bargaining position of the public body and the chair so declares DPW negotiations.
Okay. I have a motion and a second. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Rajesh Kumar?
Yes.
Mr. Hadley?
Yes.
Mr. Ruccio?
Yes.
Ms. Bonson?
Yes.
Mr. Crowley?
Yes.
And we will not be coming back into open session. Thank you. You dumping that?